So, hello everybody, everybody with pants in here, everybody with pants at or without pants at home. So that seems to be the joke today. Welcome everybody to this session where I'll give you a brief introduction to the topic of functional safety. This is not intended to be a complete functional safety training. It will not work as 20 years of functional safety experience, with also I do not have. It's really for those who want to have their first impression about what's functional safety, get an overview and decide maybe if they want to go deeper into the field or if they just want to avoid it at all. So what I will be talking about today, I give a brief introduction to me, give you the introduction to functional safety, what do you need to do during development to achieve functional safety, what to do after your first release, how to keep up with your safety, and then hopefully answer some of your questions. So, somebody coming? Come in. So, who is this? So, I'm part of Electrometers. We are a small tech consultancy company focusing a lot about functional safety, software quality, let's say anything related to software risk, security, license compliance. We are working as independent consultants, independent assessors, and we provide trainings and workshops. So, it's us, our founders, so, and about me. I've been working in production maintenance, automotive, EC development, mainly automotive since 1999. Actually, all my projects had to do something with functional safety, so it somehow was something I couldn't avoid, obviously. And then about 10 years ago, I started really to focus on functional safety and to work as a safety assessor and safety expert, mainly in the automotive field. Currently, I'm supporting my customers with functional safety, security, and the compliant use of open source projects. I'm also involved here in a few of the Linux Foundation projects. I'm part of OpenChain. I'm in the ELISA Medical Group, and I'm the functional safety manager of the CEFA project. What else? I'm an outdoorsy person. I like live music, and very important, I'm really not good with faces and with names. So if I don't greet you on the hallway, I'm not ignoring you. Just give me a shout out that we know each other. I might just not recognize your face, especially with the face mask on at the moment. So, what's functional safety? So, let's say when I come into projects for the first time, a lot of people have exactly these four statements for me. Someday it's just part of the daily bullshit bingo. I should just, you know, if I say safety and security often enough a day, everybody's happy. It's something I need a certificate for. If I have a certificate, everything is fine. If I don't have a certificate, nothing is fine. Some find functional safety the first time in some RFQ they get from the customers. They have no idea what they should do, if this is really important, if it changes things they do. And for some, it's just another buzzword, like, yeah, safety, security, that's what we do these days, isn't it? But where are we? Okay, actually, it's nothing of that. It's something completely different. So what's really functional safety? Functional safety, it's defined as the freedom of unacceptable risk of physical injury or also of damage to health of people, of goods, either directly or indirectly as a result of damage of property or to the environment. So functional safety is the part of safety that depends on a system or equipment operating correctly in response to its inputs. And mainly when you have a functional safe system, it's about detecting potentially dangerous conditions, resulting either then in the activation of a protective or corrective device or measure to prevent exactly this hazardous event to happen, or mitigation measures to mitigate the effect of the hazard. So in functional safety, we really like to talk a lot about safety, risk, and harm. With safety always being the freedom of unacceptable risk. So really, it's not the complete freedom of risk. Everything is a risk. Hi, Kate. Risk usually, then always in the way of functional safety defines it, is always a combination of the probability of a harm done and the severity of a harm. And with harm, we in functional safety always mean the injury or the death of one or more persons, severe impact on the environment, damage of goods, and so on. And yeah, I can't say it often enough, it's always to minimize the risk to an acceptable level. And usually, the definition, it's not so easy, but it's easy to understand. It's the risk that is accepted by society. So this can change. And it's really about accepting and minimizing risk. You know, when we step out there, we can be hit by a truck. When we step out there and we look left and we look right and we take care, we minimize our risk to get hit by a truck. That's so easy. Then, I'm not sure in the English-speaking world, I'm German, and we only have one word that's for safety and security, and let's say, generally my perception is people who have to do with safety and security for the first time, for them it's just the same. And actually, they are siblings. With, let's say, at the moment, safety being the less attractive sibling of the two. But safety is something different than security. While safety really means prevention and detection and management of random faults and the reduction of systematic faults by application of processes and methods, security means really the prevention, detection, and management of malicious attacks. So overall, we can say, there is no need for security if your safety already fails and you get killed by your device before a hacker would even start. So mainly I think most people are interested how to reach and how to achieve functional safety during development. So how can you really identify the safety criticality of your product in the beginning? How do you start then with development? What do you need to consider? And how do you verify your results? And the most important thing here really is consider your safety criticality really from the start. If you don't consider it from the start, it will be really, really hard to re-engineer safety into your product. Make really sure from the beginning on that you know the physical and functional scope of your product and analyze what are the worst things that can happen when your system has a malfunction. So what are the important points you need to consider right from the beginning? Really know your system and know your use cases, know your intended functionality, the system boundaries. What's your scope? What are the interfaces to the connected systems? What's expected there? And what are the use cases? What do you really need to consider in a safety critical way? Also, know the environment. What are the environmental factors your system needs to withstand? What is the load? What are the resources that your system has to work on? And know your intended user. Will it be a product expert? Will it more be a B2B product? Will it be a consumer product? What can really happen? It really also depends on the user, on the qualification of the user and of the use cases. Let's say in safety speak, that mainly means, create your item definition or your definition of units of observation, your equipment under control definition. So I think most people have already heard there's a lot of safety standards and they all call this a different name, but in the end it always comes down to know the scope of your system, know the interfaces, know the use cases, know the intended audience. So how to start? I've been thinking a lot about what would be a right example. So I'm coming from the automotive domain. I don't want to be too specific to the automotive, so let's build a house. So first thing to consider, what kind of house do we want to build? So then where do we want to build it? What are the climate conditions, or what's the environment? What do we need to consider? What are the interfaces of the house? What's the functionality of a house at all? So it just say very easily, we want to build a very small cottage-like house, 2 bedrooms max, really simple approach, so we won't have a lot of contractors. We really want to build a small, simple house. We want to place this house somewhere in a mid-European climate, freezing winters, warm summers, heavy storms, but no severe storms, no severe weather. So we're not in Siberia, we're not in some desert. We just have, yeah, it can be warm, it can be really cold, but it will not blow the roof off. The house also comes with interfaces, so it will be connected to the water mains, gas mains, electricity, and we will also have a glass fiber cable. And so the intended functionality of our house is pretty simple. We want the house to keep us dry during rain, warmer winter, protect us against wind, have a place of the for the personal hygiene and a cooking facility, and it should offer some privacy and room for our stuff. Then I said, okay, know what can happen to your house or to your system. So we need to really start to define the scenarios. What can our, so doing our hazard and risk analysis, starting with the scenarios our house or our system can be in. So the house, it stands there during daytime, during nighttime. It stands there during different temperatures. We can put these already in classes. I think it's pretty obvious. Freezing is one of the classes. Let's say a pleasant ambient temperature, something between freezing and normal room temperature, so 20 Celsius, 65 Fahrenheit, something like that. Something that's a little bit unpleasant, more than 20 degrees Celsius and 40, and maybe above 40. Our house can be exposed to fog, to light rain, heavy rain, light snowfall, heavy snowfall, and hail. So our scenarios then would be the combination of our situations the house can be in, like, yeah, daytime, the temperature class is freezing and we have no wind. Or daytime, it's freezing, we have light rain and no wind. So more or less a black ice situation. Additionally, then we would come in and saying, okay, define the possible malfunctions behavior, like what happens in the situation when we have no provision of fresh water, or when we have no provision of heating, when we have no rain protection, or maybe when the glass fiber cable is cut or our router just isn't working properly. In the end, it then comes down and on the third parameter, it's how controllable is the situation for you in that moment. So we will always have, for the criticality, a combination of exposure, severity, and controllability. So when we think back about our scenario, saying, okay, it's daytime, it's freezing, and the water main is off, or we don't have fresh water, we can't control it, but it might not be so severe as long as it's for not too long. If we have the same situation and the heating is off, it looks a little bit different. If we have the same situation and our network connection is gone, it's very unpleasant, yes, but it will not affect, let's say, the functionality of the house in a way than if the roof is missing or if the heating is missing. So coming back to, let's say, our classic functional safety standards, they will always give you some kind of way to rate this. either in a more generic way or the domain-specific standards, they will come up with domain-specific scenarios, domain-specific exposure rates, ideas how to rate the harm, how to rate the controllability. Just put up here the examples coming from ISO 26262, which is the automotive standard I mainly work with. And based on these tables, you then rate the criticality of your safety goals. So what's a safety goal? So the safety goal is then the situation you really want to avoid or the hazardous event you want to prevent. So you want to prevent a situation either night or day when it's freezing and your heating will die. And you might want to do this with a very high integrity. You say you want to avoid a loss of your glass fiber cable signals because you need to work. If it's gone, you cannot work, you cannot pay for electricity, so you have the same problem, which might not be so severe than having immediate frost into your house, but maybe you even give it a criticality, give it a low one. In the safety world, we have a lot of names for criticality, depending on the standard. So the mother of all safety standards, the IEC 61548, it calls it SIL. It says SIL 1 is the lowest, SIL 4 is the highest. SIL stands for safety integrity level. The automotive world wanted to do things completely different, but the same. So they had the automotive safety integrity level, but they didn't rate it from 1 to 4. They said, okay, it's A to B. In the IEC 13.8.4, which is a machinery standard, they say they want a performance level. And similarly, in the agricultural standard, they want an agricultural performance level. So in the end, it always comes down to a level that will give you a value for how really severe and how important is it to achieve the safety goal or to enable the safety function to work. The standards give you tables, again, standards love tables, rating which exposure rate with which controllability and severity will result in which level of safety integrity. So typical examples for safety goals is, for example, for an EPS, an electric power steering, is that any kind of self-steering should be avoided. So self-steering means when you move the steering wheel, you have this steering support. It's not hydraulic anymore, it's electric or electronic. And it should really support you and not move into the other direction, because that would mean you could crash somewhere. So say, okay, it's really hard to control this maybe, so we put this an ASIL-D, because you can crash, you can die, you can't control it, maybe. For an airbag system, the airbag, for example, the safety goal is one of the safety goals is the airbag must not deploy if it's not in a crash. And you also can crash in the situation where this happens. You usually are in the situation not being in a crash is usually very high, so the exposure is very high. You nearly have no chance to control the situation, so it might also result in an ASIL-D. For communicating safety critical signals on the bus, it might be lower depending on what criticality the receiving system expects. Could be, for example, an ASIL-B. For our house, for example, as a more generic example, means a loss of water supply in the kitchen and bathroom must be avoided with a high criticality. Penetration of rain, snow, or any other kind of moisture must be avoided, also with a high criticality. And we said, okay, loss of signal processing of the signals on the glass fiber line must be avoided with a low criticality. So that's a really nice theory if you start from scratch and if you have a complete system where you really know the harm. But what should you do when you can't identify the harm? So usually when you're far away from the end application, you're a small software library, you're the operating system, you're the hypervisor, you're whatever, but you don't, you're really important, but you have no idea what the application has really done. If it's a power steering, if it's an airbag system, you have no idea. So what can you do in this situation? So there's a standard phrasing for this, means safety element out of context. Actually, that just means a safety element that currently does not know its context. So it always comes with a context, and you will need to cater for this context. And actually, I prefer more the phrasing safety element than with an assumed context. The best practices here is really try to get as much information as possible about the applications that use you, or that use your component, and what are the expectations. Do they have a high criticality? Do they have a medium criticality? What parts of your library, of your system are used? Then that might result in more or less effort, but that's really always a starting point. Then really make qualified assumptions about the dreaded events of your system. So really, what are the claims? What do you really want to do in a very reliable and very good way? And what should not or must not fail in your library, in your system? And then really, based on what you learned about the applications that use your system, based on what are the situations or the system states that you want to avoid, really make your safety claim saying, okay, my library can do this in a safety critical way because it can detect this and that, and it gives you that error state. And it does this with this and that integrity level. And so the next thing then really that comes into the mind, what's a safe state? A safe state then is defined as a state where no harm can be caused by your component anymore. Usually it's a state that you enter when encountering a problem. So defining really if you detect a problem, or even maybe some external system signals you a problem, you might want to go into a safe state, meaning, for example, completely shutting off your communication, sending maybe not an error signal, removing, if you're in a big system with servo motors, really remove maybe the torque, or apply a mechanical brake, reboot maybe. But the important thing really is think about your safe state, also on component level, what do you do if you encounter a problem? And then also, how do you make sure that you stay in the safe state, that you just don't forget about it, boot up again, and then crash? So then, yeah, that's a lot of thinking in the beginning. And yeah, for me, that's one of the most important things, because that's where the value in the end comes from. But that's just the beginning. So once you know what are your safety goals, your safety claims, what are the situations you want to avoid, you really want to start with safety developing your system. Then usually you define safety requirements that describe then the functionalities you really need to achieve your safety goals, that you really need to implement to achieve your safe state. You will come up usually with a preliminary architecture. You have an architecture in your mind that you want to follow to achieve your functional safety, or also your normal functionality. And this all together, the requirements, the safety goals, your preliminary architecture, that results in the safety concept. And I think here in open source, we know this concept rather well. They all inherit the safety goals, safe criticality. So for me, also safety criticality, it's kind of copyleft. You won't get rid of it. Once you have it, you won't get rid of it. So usually you do this in quite a systematic way. You take your safety goals and you really go blah, 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 one by the other, defining your safety requirements. And assigning or inheriting your safety criticality level. So from do this for one safety goal, do this for the other safety goal, you will find in reality that some requirements will in the end work towards more than one safety goal. So for our health, that for example could mean that the house should keep us warm, so the house must have a heating system. This heating system requirement inherits the high criticality. It needs to be traced to its original safety goals. We call this just safety goal heating. And a good requirement always has a state, so it can be proposed, it can be just a draft, it can be under review, it can be it can be rejected, and it can be approved, more or less. So for the heating, another mechanism, for example, would be to detect if the heating is off or if the temperatures are frozen. A requirement could be, okay, the heating must switch itself on the moment it's getting too cold in the house. So really go through your safety goals and define what do you need to achieve this functional safety. So in the end, for our electrical power steering, this could mean, because we said we don't want to have a steering in the wrong direction or self-steering, you need to detect something to detect the torque of your power steering. And in reality, you always have a failure reaction time. In a draft state, you might not have everything completely defined. So when you have a draft, it's completely legal to have a TBD still there. So go from there, go iteratively, define what you need. An important point, even from the beginning, or especially at the beginning, when you come up with your safety requirements, and especially when you come up with your safety architecture, avoid dependent failures. Dependent failure could be, for example, the power line, can be everything that either results in a common cause failure, which is the failure of two systems with the same root cause, or a cascading failure when the fault of one component of your item causes the fault of the other one. So, for example, I think the easiest example here is our house. For example, we say, okay, we need a redundant approach for our heating. We will have a central heating that's running on the gas that we have on the gas mains, and we have, in case this fails, we have electrical heaters in some of the rooms. First point is, okay, yeah, if the central heating is not running, if it's failing, switch on the electrical heaters and you're fine. So what happens when your power is off? The control of your central heating will fail. So even you say, okay, you don't need electricity to burn gas, but you need electricity to run the control of your heating, so your central heating is off. And your electrical heaters in the rooms are off. So you have a common root cause for both your heating systems to fail. Yeah. And yeah, unfortunately, there's a cascading failure. Once you have freezing temperatures in combination with this, your water pipes will freeze, they will burst, and then you have no heating and no water. And I know somebody who knows exactly this situation. So when you're actually then really creating your safety concept and your system design, you will really see, yeah, you have a pretty stable safety concept and preliminary architecture in the beginning, but once you really go into the technical details, defining what do you really want to use, what kind of sensors do you want to use, what kind of algorithms, you will go into a more iterative approach where you say, okay, this is a technical solution I want to have. I analyze if my architecture, if my solution really fulfills the safety goals that I have, if I can keep up my safety requirements, my monitoring, my diagnostics, and then come up in the end after analysis and maybe iterating over your over your technical requirements to a system design and system level, or if you just have a library, software level requirements. So I said we in safety love to talk about risk and risk reduction. So actually in functional safety we have two measures to reduce the risk that comes with our system. On the one hand side, we have the claim to have a robust design, to have reliable components in our architecture, and to have an architecture that's actually suitable for what we intend to do. And on the other hand side, we say, okay, and we really want to develop this in a way that we really have this in the end. So aspect number one, the robust design, means really create a robust system architecture. If the architecture is not robust enough, you can apply the most beautiful process on it, you can spend millions on testing, it will still be crap. So crap in is crap out, no matter how beautiful the process is. When we talk about reusing components, hardware components and also software components, use reliable components. Use components you trust, use components you know, and maybe components where you also have a formal proof or that they are useful and that they are reliable in your safety application. Avoid common and cascading faults. That's really, yeah, in your design, in your architecture. Analyze if there are any. And yeah, analyze the suitability of your design. Will your monitoring work? Will your diagnostic work? Will your safety measures work? Will you have cascading failures? Are you really sure? So really analyze the heck out of your system before you proceed. So here are some history lessons, something that I also presented 2 years ago together with Philip. Safety architectures. So there are a lot of approaches to safety architectures. Here are just most basic ideas. Back in history, the simplest system we can think of, it has an input, it has some processing, and it has an output. So here we say, okay, we want to launch a rocket. We have a 1 out of 1 architecture, which means we just have one path for all the processing. We don't have any monitoring, and we won't have any chance to see if anything goes wrong in our processing chain. We have no chance to see, is our input signal right? We have no chance to see, is our algorithm right? And we cannot even read back what are we doing in the end. And no matter how much process we put in there, how much testing, this will not be safe. A little bit better approach would be to have a two-channel system where we say, okay, we have two processing lines, both lines need to come to the conclusion, yeah, it's safe, it's what we do want to do, launch the rocket. It has some beauty in this approach. The problem is, in the end, the availability of the system here, it's, oh, you know, I'm a safety person, I say, okay, if the rocket does not launch, we might lose a lot of money, but it's safe. So another approach would be, yeah, one of these are enough. Oops, it's going back. And yeah, first approach on a more, let's say, sophisticated solution would be a 2 out of 3 system where two paths need to agree that it's safe to launch the rocket. I'm coming from the automotive world. This starts to be expensive. They don't like it. So the other aspect then is the process. So really make sure that what you develop is what you wanted to develop. So in the end, that you have a safe system. That means you need solid planning of all your activities. You need to have an established or defined process. You need to have suitable methods to really implement what you want to do. And you need to have measures to verify and to test. Why do you need this process? Yeah, to ensure that you get what you wanted. It's simple as that. You want a house. You don't want to have a wall missing in the end and your neighbors looking into your living room. You want to have the roof covering the your complete house, and you want to have a house actually with windows and with doors to keep your privacy. You also know it's not only you contributing in this project, so you want to make sure everybody is working in the same way. There's a common understanding, and by that you ensure also traceability, maintainability, and verifiability of what you do. Actually, the process that comes with a safety project, I don't want to call it a V model, but in the end, it always comes down to this chain. You need to define a requirement. You need to put this in an architecture, or you need to create an architecture. You need to analyze if this is really what you wanted. You need to implement it. You need to test it. You need to verify it, and then start again. In the end, it will be iterations about little Vs. Then, yeah, walking through this V or your little iterations, you will start with requirements management. Requirements need to be naturally unambiguous and complete. You need to define your requirements using a suitable description language. It could be natural language, could be more structured language, could be some graphical representation models, whatever is suitable for your use cases. You need to make sure they are verified and complete. Otherwise, you might end up with just a half a roof if you don't describe it unambiguously that you want to have a full roof. And the best practice here to really ensure this is when you write your requirements, always add your acceptance criteria so you can, it's already a model in your mind saying, okay, I want this, how do I verify that I really got this? Then architecture, I think we all know an architecture of a house in the realms of software. That means define your data types, define your interfaces internally and externally, define the static and the dynamic aspects of your architecture, make sure in your architecture that functionality in data is encapsulated as much as possible, and that it's structured in a way that you enable modifications and maintenance. I think implementation is the thing we all know most about. Use a suitable programming language. My programming language I speak is C90. We can discuss how suitable that is. Make sure you avoid the pitfalls of your programming language. Yeah, C90. There are a lot of guidelines how to avoid the pitfalls. Have your variables as local as possible. Don't use magic numbers, no hidden data flow. Don't do unconditional jumps. Let's say for the seasoned coder, there's nothing new on that. Make a robust and stable code. And in the end, you need to verify and test that you really got this, what you wanted. There are several test methods that you need to consider. You need to have requirements-based test. You need to test your interfaces, maybe the interoperability with your environment, the robustness, how does your system react to unexpected inputs, to higher loads, whatever. Fault injection tests, really make sure that your safety mechanisms work. And what's really fancy and done very often in model-based development is really back-to-back tests, running the model against the compiled code. When you then do your tests and your verification, you rate this by test coverage, really making sure you walk through all your loops, you walk through all your decision points, you cover all the functionality, you don't have code that's not tested. Maybe that would mean this is code that's not specified, because if you have a requirements-based test, and you also walk through all the loops or all the decision points that you have, and there's some code you cannot reach, it's either unreachable code by design, you need to analyze this, or it's something that came in whatever way, and you might consider removing this or adding this to your specification, analyzing if this has any impact. Best practices here are really, automate as much as possible. Check for the basics like compilability, coding guidelines, and so on before you allow a check-in, and fix your problems ASAP because they will grow. And how much time do we have? Perfect. The foundation of everything here is a functional safety management. As a foundation of a house, it's the basis and foundation of everything. Everything would fall apart if you don't have this. Each kind of standard, safety standard, quality standard, they come with functional safety management and supporting processes. They all have some kind of functional safety planning, meaning you create and maintain a functional safety plan. Plan from the beginning what you want to do, how you want to do it, who needs to do it, and when do you want to do it. Need to plan your skill management, roles and responsibilities, plan your verification methods, also resources, so we won't get a surprise in the end. As I said before already, you need to plan your requirements management. Important point where I've seen that it comes to some confusion is the configuration management. So configuration management in the sense of safety standards does not mean having configurations like something that happens during compile time. It means really versioning, branching. What do you need to use to keep your information in? Will you use Git or SVN or some proprietary solution? How do you want to use it? Documentation management, so in which format and how do you want to keep all the information you create during your development? Change management, how can changes be proposed? Who decides on a change? How is a change implemented and verified? Important and very, let's say, non-loved topic is the tool chain management. Tool is the same as for me as a person. It needs to be reliable, it needs to be trustable. You need to be sure that it does what you want it to do, that it won't introduce a problem into your product, or for a testing tool, for example, that it won't mask a problem that you might have. And if you pull in or use components from a third party, from outside, really make sure how do you want to qualify, if they are in the safety path, how do you want to qualify it, can you qualify it, what are your expectations to external components. And then, last point here is really keeping up the safety after your first release, having a safe change management in place, so really planning from the beginning what do you want to do or what do you need to do to keep up your safety when you implement a change, because you will implement a change. On the one hand side, you have maybe some security bugs, or you hopefully have a lot of new features you want to implement. You have requests from users who want new features. You come up with new features, and you need to do this in a way so your functional safety, all your efforts that you put in already, are not compromised. So really, for each change that or change request that comes in, analyze what would be the impact of the change to the safety of your system. What will be affected, maybe, if you implement this change? What components do you need to add to change? Will you have an architectural impact? For this, you see, your detailed product architecture is key so that you really can see in an analysis, do you have a safety impact and how would it impact my safety? Document everything that's related to this change, to the things actually changed, how you changed it, when it, did it change, and verify these changes. Usually, that means also running all your old test cases. As I said, automate as much as possible to avoid regressions. And in the end, it comes down to ensuring that all development, all changes that are done to your product in, with your change request are verified and tested and are implemented in a way that you did implement, define, and test your original product. So that's my short flight over what should you know from as functional safety basics. I didn't talk about a lot of things because you know, functional safety training usually is 4 or 5 days. Then that's considered then a functional safety basic training. I really wanted to give you a first overview, what's up with functional safety. So I didn't talk about safety verification methods, what's an inspection, why do I need a checklist? What's a Fagan inspection, formal verification, and so on. I didn't go in detail about safety analysis methods, FMEA, FDA, STPA. I didn't talk about production maintenance and decommissioning. I didn't talk about safety audits and assessments, certifications, and so on. I didn't talk about confirmation measures. Specifics of certain safety standards. I didn't talk about hardware, MTTFD, PMHF, fit rates. This is a I could go on with this for several days, so just be happy that's just 1.5 hours that we have here. What I want to tell you, safety is it's not magic, but it's a complex topic, so go through it step by step. Ask questions if you have them. It's the worst thing that can happen that you have an unsafe product because you didn't dare to ask. So just thank you everybody for being here. Thank you everybody for being online. Any more questions? So your question is, are there already measures like graceful degradation in open source software that we could detect maybe by analysis or scanning or what? Safety in open source, it's something that's still in the, Kate, just stop me if I talk nonsense, but it's something that's still in the starting phase. So there are several projects that have functional safety in mind and that come up step by step with the measures they need from safety claim to maybe qualifying existing parts of the software, identifying exactly what you said, what you need or what you might need. Are there already, maybe from the quality side or from the stability side, degradation measures, detection measures? But there is no, no one exact same approach at the moment. So it's really something where you manually need to ask the project or need to analyze the functionality of the code. Is there something in there that you can use for this? And then somehow trying to also to get, let's say, the systematic integrity into it to make sure that it's exactly doing what you expect it to do. But there's, unfortunately, there is no one-fits-all solution at the moment. Yeah, I think yeah, Elisa might be the hook in point for you because yeah, naturally it's very hardware near, and it's, I think that Kate, that's the architectural group that's really working on what are the safety measures that we can identify, right? Okay. Yeah, so the virtual meetings usually are in a friendly time for the US. Kind of friendly. Okay. Yeah, I do have in Munich my ELISA call at 6 p.m., so. Yeah, but we can facilitate the times in between, so it has a good and a bad. Welcome. Any more questions? So if anything comes up, you can find me via email, you can find me on GitHub and Twitter, you can text me on LinkedIn. Stefano contacted me today in the morning, so usually I check these, just if you have any more questions, don't hesitate. If I can answer it, I'll give you an answer. If I can't, I also will tell you that I can't. So, okay. Then thanks so much for being here.